cos'è questo?
Come si accende?
Okay, so I think we can start, and it's really a great pleasure to welcome Professor Zurek, our colloquium speaker today. So before leaving the floor to him, I would like to give a brief introduction to his bio. So Wojciech Zurek got his PhD in Poland, and then he moved, I just made a mistake. He studied in Poland and then got his PhD in Belgium. No. In
Austin, Texas.
Oh, okay. Austin. I got confused because you just told me that you work in the same institute with Prigozhin. I found that
he was.
So I was fooled. I mean, I shouldn't ask you more information. And then I got confused. Okay. So I will keep reading, okay? And then he moved for a few years in Caltech, where he was Tolman Fellow, and then in 85 he moved to Los Alamos, where he has been there since then. And in 96 he became laboratory fellow of Los Alamos. So. Professor Zurek gave seminal contribution in several areas of physics, quantum information, foundation of quantum mechanics, non-equilibrium many-body systems. I mean, I'm pretty sure you heard about the famous Kibble-Zurek mechanism. He got several prizes, von Humboldt Prize, Smoluchowski Prize. Since a few years, he's... Chair, Albert Einstein Chair of at University of Ulm. So with this, I apologize for the mistake, and okay, I hope this is the only one I make today. And please, thank you.
It is good?
Yeah.
Now I'm good. Okay. I'm glad I'm good. So, the goal of today's lecture is to investigate whether we can understand the universe we live in using quantum theory. Now, the problem is, of course, that our everyday world is classical. And yet we know that at the Is this good? Okay. I shall try to convince you that the answer is yes. I will tell you what I will tell you shortly. But before I tell you anything, let me emphasize that I invite questions during the talk. Right? I will stop a couple of times, but whenever you feel you are not following something, please ask. Now, while I invite questions, I reserve the right to suppress them. So what I shall talk about has a history which goes back to decoherence. And I shall do an overview of it in the first one-third of the talk. This research was done with colleagues, and I'm delighted to see one of them in the front row, Juan Pablo Paz. I shall express then dissatisfaction, not with his work, but with the assumptions of decoherence. And I shall tell you what else I would like to do. And so in a sense, the theme is to go beyond decoherence, understand the emergence of the classical beyond decoherence. Now, to this end, I shall explain to you how quantum jumps, things that define events within the quantum universe, can come about with fewer assumptions than the ones that go into the discussions of decoherence. And in particular, I shall derive for you the rule for probabilities, so-called Born's rule, probability is equal to amplitude square. There are two popular review talks, review papers. They include also the subject to which I will probably not get to. It's quantum Darwinism, and this is ongoing with several colleagues of whom Mike Zvolak and Jess Rydell are most active. Let me start with a quote. The quote is from Albert Einstein, letter to Max Born, dated about 1 year before Einstein died. He writes, "Let psi 1 and psi 2 be two solutions of the same Schrödinger equation. When the system is a macro system, can of Coke, chair, and when psi 1 and psi 2 are localized, narrow with respect to position, can of Coke right here, then in by far the greater number of cases, this is not true for the superposition. That is, if I have a Coke which can be here or can be here, both are legal quantum states, legal classical states, a legal quantum state is also a Coke being in superposition of here and there. So Einstein concludes, narrowness with respect to macro coordinates is not only independent of the principles of quantum theory, but is moreover incompatible with them. Now that's a very pointed statement of why we should worry about the correspondence between quantum and classical. And we know, and I won't belabor it, examples which are exotic and perverse, but you know, these things should happen on a daily basis. Things would get into superposition just under the usual evolution of quantum systems. One good quote calls for another. So here is another quote. Space is big, really big. You just won't believe how hugely, mind-bogglingly big it is. Where does it come from? Yeah? Yeah, somebody knows literature. Hitchhiker's Guide to Galaxy. I'm going to complete it slightly. So another way of stating the same problems that Einstein called attention to is to realize that the space of quantum possibilities, of all possible quantum states, contains many more states than we are used to in the classical corner. So somehow we should understand how this enormous space of possibilities where every superposition of every superposition is a legal state becomes constricted to what we see in our daily life. Now, the story that I think many of you know, so I will go through it reasonably quickly, is that decoherence does that job. And it's true, and I shall tell you why, and I shall tell you why I'm not quite happy with how decoherence does that job. Decoherence recognizes that systems, especially the ones we encounter in our daily life, tend to be immersed in the environment, and they interact with it. And it recognizes that even very weak interaction can have profound effect on the behavior of the systems. And in particular, it's basically responsible for constricting the range of possibilities available to quantum states. So what is decoherence? What does decoherence do? Imagine an initial state of the system which is some superposition of states. So psi s is a state, quantum state of the system. It is a some superposition of states. It interacts with an initial state of the environment. That interaction is perfectly quantum mechanical, Schrodinger equation, unitarity, etc., etc. And when that happens, it generally will lead to an entangled state of the system and the environment. This entangled state expresses both of them, is still pure, but if you are interested in system only, then you can trace out the degrees of freedom of the environment. And if you do that, you will end up with an object we are all familiar with, a density matrix. Density matrices were introduced by Landau and used by von Neumann, you know, 3-5 years after the beginning of quantum mechanics. What has not been realized is that when this sort of thing happens, then in many cases, the ones that we are familiar with, the set of states which will end up on the diagonal of this density matrix is the same. There are states into which the system habitually decoheres. In other words, if you were to start in one of these preferred states, the interaction with the environment would do nothing to it. What decides what states survive and what don't? Well, the Hamiltonian of interaction. And there is a very simple condition that you can guess, which is that if a set of states commutes with this Hamiltonian of interactions, then nothing will happen to them. So these preferred states are selected primarily through the interaction with the environment. The story is longer, and I won't tell you the whole story, but that interaction selects preferred pointer states. The process is known as environment-induced superselection, or for short, Ein selection. So you get a preferred set of states, and these preferred sets of states will play a role of basically classical states. They are immune to the interaction with the environment. They are not perturbed by it. Other states can't exist, can't persist. Claim is then, you know, if I were to try to put Coke can in a superposition of being here and there, that state is not stable. And I will tell you a bit more why. So, very simple example. Suppose I have a superposition of a spin, 0 and 1. Suppose I couple it to the environment in such a way that 0 and 1 diagonalize the Hamiltonian of interaction. And then suppose that the environment has plenty of similar spins. That interaction, after a time corresponding to how strong it is, will make this density matrix, which is off-diagonal terms, expressing the fact that this initial state is projection operator, is pure, is going to make it deteriorate into something which is diagonal in the states which are on the diagonal of the Hamiltonian of interaction. So this is environment-induced superselection. There are certain states which are immune to the environment. If you started in 0 or 1, nothing would happen. You can turn this property of states being able to survive in spite of the interaction with the environment into a method of selecting them. The method goes under the name of predictability sieve. Basically, you investigate every state in the Hilbert space, let it interact with the environment, and see what happened to it. It's best to characterize how badly it was damaged by just a single number. In the ideal case, these states 0 and 1 would not be damaged at all. In general, some of them would be damaged just a little bit. Many of them would be really badly damaged. The way to see how much damage happened is to calculate something like entropy, or here, something easier to calculate, purity, trace rho square. Then you have a list of all the states in the Hilbert space, and there are purities at the end after some interaction with the environment happened. If that list is stable, things don't get rearranged over time, then the states which are most pure, which are less disturbed by the environment, near the top of that list, would form sort of a classical peak. Now, here is a poor example of trying to, you know, use two dimensions to represent something which lives in multidimensional Hilbert space. Let's look at a simple example, but slightly more sophisticated than the one we just talked about. Reduction of the wave packet in quantum Brownian motion. So this is a favorite example of physicists. It's a bunch of harmonic oscillators. My system is this harmonic oscillator, a ball rolling on a bottom of a harmonic potential. My environment is a bunch of harmonic oscillators which are summarized as a field. The coupling couples to the position of the harmonic oscillator. This is a coupling constant, and this is coupling to the field. The system is linear, can be solved exactly. You can trace out the field, and you can get an equation for the density matrix of the system alone, right? You get that equation, and this was obtained with increasing accuracy over the years, and the final deed was done in a paper co-authored by Juan Pablo, 20 years ago? More. Yeah. Amazing. Anyway, it's an exact solution. I will not write an exact solution. It has three more terms. It's more complicated. I will tell you what happens when temperatures are sort of room temperature, balmy, high, right? Because these terms dominate. In this case, the equation for density matrix, and I write it in position-position representation, right? So it's like spin up, spin down here. It's plenty of different positions, matrix, position, position. Has three terms. One of them is von Neumann equation. Schrodinger equation rewritten for the density matrix. The other of them turns out governs damping, removes energy or slows down the motion. And the last one is this funny term which looks like this. Let me now suggest we do something which shouldn't be done, which is let h bar go to zero, or at least become very small. This is not a danger, this is not a limit you should take. I'm doing it for a purpose, because if I take h bar to be very small, terms which eliminate, this is classical limit, terms which eliminate quantumness should blow up. And indeed, the term which will dominate is the one which has h bar squared in the denominator. So, for a moment, let me ignore the two top terms. We know what they do. And let me just deal with an equation which says this is equal to this. What will that do? This takes the initial density matrix and gets rid of terms which are not on the diagonal, where x is not equal to x prime. Right? You can see it. There is a damping which has to do with this coefficient. And when x is equal to x prime, nothing happens. But with x, when x is not equal to x prime, that part of the density matrix is suppressed. How does it look like? Well, let's think about something that would happen in a double slit experiment. A delocalized particle going through two slits at the same time, or delocalized Coca-Cola can, separation between the two terms in superposition delta x. The density matrix of a pure state like this is represented here. under diagonal two Gaussian peaks, because I assume these things are Gaussian, and away from the diagonal also two Gaussian peaks. They represent coherence, purity. They allow the double slit experiment to result in interference. What will the master equation do to it? Well, it's not going to attach things which are under diagonal, but it's going to suppress things which are away from the diagonal. In other words, after a little bit of time, this will happen. When this happens, interference pattern disappears. The question now is how quickly it happens. So let's calculate. We know that a term which controls decoherence, the one that multiplies, that will tell you how quickly the off-diagonal terms shrink, is proportional to the term which is responsible for loss of energy. Here is actually loss of momentum, right? So you would say, look, let me just isolate my system extremely well, and I will prevent decoherence. And it's certainly a step in the right direction, but the numbers are difficult to meet. So let's see what they are for a typical macroscopic but not big thing. This is a formula, by the way, for the rate of decoherence in terms of gamma, in terms of rate of energy dumping. It is equal to gamma multiplied by the separation between the peaks and expressed in what turns out to be thermal de Broglie wavelengths. Let me calculate it for a system which is macroscopic, 1 gram, not huge, but macroscopic, which has a separation of 1 centimeter, again, macroscopic, but not huge. And it's a thermal de Broglie wavelengths because I took the equation in high temperature case. Let me take temperature of room temperature, 300 degrees Kelvin. It turns out that this factor is 10 to power 40. Just to put things in perspective, if I were able to isolate the system so that it loses its energy on a Hubble timescale, which is 10 to the 17 seconds, decoherence would disappear on a timescale of 10 to the minus 23 seconds. So even when I'm able to isolate things very well, coherence is very hard to maintain. Clearly, decoherence is very effective. It has been, by now, confirmed by a number of experimental, by a number of experiments. Very quick summary, sorry. Something happened here which I didn't want to. Yeah. A very quick summary of what decoherence does. It gets rid of superpositions very quickly. A principle of superposition loses its validity in open systems. It points out which states are preferred. They are the candidates for classical states. There are methods like predictability sieve to find out which states are the good ones. And there is this process of environment-induced superselection, which promotes these stable states. And for macroscopic systems, decoherence and ion selection can be extremely effective. We've seen it on this example, 1 gram, 1 centimeter, room temperature, enormously quick decoherence. So in a way, this is the answer of how the Hilbert space of quantum mechanics gets restricted to the set of states which are classical. One can talk about it in context of interpretations. I won't do it. I want to take another look at the basic of decoherence. But this is perhaps a good point to stop and see if there are any urgent questions, or even not urgent. Please. The strength of the coupling. In that case, well, I'm not going to go back there, but there is a formula there which says gamma in this model is equal to epsilon square, where epsilon was the strength of the coupling of the Hamiltonian, divided by 2 or something like this, right? So, you know, if you decouple completely, gamma disappears. Gamma is good because it's something, you know, people measure. Experimentalists tell you about Q factor. Q factor is you know, what gamma, another way of talking about gamma. So the fact that you can have a Q which is humongous, very well isolated system, and yet hard time keeping coherence is part of that story. Any other questions? I don't know if that was this clear or this confusing. Okay. So here we have a story. We know how preferred states arise. We can calculate. People have done experiments. Predictions of the theory are confirmed by the experiment. Why aren't we happy? Let's revisit foundations of quantum mechanics. So here is a list of axioms abstracted from a good textbook. A good textbook is Dirac. To me, it's still the Bible. Let me go through the list one by one. Quantum states live in Hilbert space, right? The sense of it is superposition principle. Every superposition of every superposition is a legal state. Evolutions are unitary. They don't destroy superpositions. They just rotate them in the Hilbert space. These two are just math. When you do your work as a theorist, that's all you need. You need a Hamiltonian, etc., a couple of ingredients, but this is what you rely on. At this point, there is no physics yet. We need to enter, or we need to smuggle in physics by making some connection with experiments. So the axiom number 3 says, immediate repetition of a measurement yields the same outcome, repeatability. I will call it sometimes repeatability, sometimes predictability, because I could rotate, let the state rotate, and I would know what measurement to make so that I get the outcome I expect. This set of 3 axioms from Dirac are uncontroversial. But then we move on to another measurement axiom. Right? So 3 is beginning to make connection with measurements. Now we make a connection which is more in your face. And here is an axiom that says outcomes are restricted to orthonormal states of some observable. Why? I mean, in classical physics, you can just find out what the state is. And here you can't. You walk up to a system, and you ask a question, and the system will not tell you I'm in this state. The system will answer the question, and it's a multiple choice question. Right? There's no other options. Also, in each run of the experiment, just one outcome happens. The next one, probability of an outcome, is given by the square of an amplitude. We know this as Born's rule. So these two axioms are different nature and come from different sort of setting than 1 through 3. I'm going to supplement them with something which is not in Dirac, but which we use now on an everyday basis. Dirac didn't worry about systems which are entangled. And when you talk about entanglement, you talk about several systems. So state of a system in a composite system is a vector in the tensor product of constituent spaces. Some people call it complexity axiom. Without it, you wouldn't have entanglement. Axioms 0 through 3 are, in my view, uncontroversial. Axioms 0 through 2 are only math. If you just do that, you are just shuffling symbols. You make no connection with predictions to experiments. You need something, and axiom 3 is going to let us in to start making connections with experiments. Axioms 4 and 5 come from a different set, and Bohr, Dirac, and others have realized that they do, and there is an inconsistency. For example, nothing seemed to say why should there be a collapse. In fact, unitarity made it impossible. So the question is, how much can we understand it without doing what they did, which is they said, look, apparatus is classical, on the border between quantum and classical, weird things can happen, so we don't need to be restricted by axioms which are purely quantum. There is another way, of course, Everett, relative states. The basic idea there is that you say the whole universe can be understood using quantum mechanics. There is lots of philosophical twists on that story. I will stay away from philosophy, but I will accept the idea that all of the universe can be understood using quantum mechanics. And I'm staying away from philosophy, but I'm emphasizing that even in Everett's story, or especially in Everett's story, you would need preferred basis. You have all the universe which is classical, but you still want to understand why localized states are preferred, right? But we have a story, right? Decoherence. So why, what am I complaining about? Why am I not happy with it? I mean, it gives you sets of states which are localized. There would be situations where measurements happen and they would be orthonormal and so on. Why worry? Well, let's go back to where the worry comes from. That's my abbreviated decoherence slide. The point is, reduced density matrix depends on averaging. When you take a trace over the environment, you are doing a mathematical operation, but when you interpret reduced density matrix as a physical object, you are interpreting things by assuming that alpha squares are probabilities. This is something one shouldn't do without careful justification. So in other words, we have, for the rest of this lecture, refrained from using Born's rule. In other words, all of these good stories that we've had about how preferred states arise are questionable, and we should rederive them in some better way. And we should, in the process, come up with a derivation of Born's rule. But to have derivation of Born's rule, we need things that can happen, events, preferred states. So the first order of business is that we need events. And again, my Bible from now on is the stuff in blue or the stuff in yellow. And I would like to understand how much of 4 and 5 can be understood from what's in yellow. Tensor products, entanglement is good. Quantum states, Hilbert space, great. Unitarity, of course. Immediate repetition or predictability, yes. The rest, we can't touch, can't use. Decoherence depends on number 5, so we are not going to use decoherence. We're going to do it from scratch. Question.
So I guess you are going to define what is an event for you. Is there something you measure or something else?
I will show you what I have, right? And then you can ask the question. But it's coming immediately, right? Almost immediately. Okay. So what's the plan? So events. Why the outcomes of measurements are limited to a certain set of things. These will be the events. Where does the limitation come from? Second point I'm going to try to do before too long is derive Born's rule. I cannot use Born's rule for any of these, right? That would be illegal. I just use the top of the list we've had before. So how do I do events? Why are measurements limited to a discrete set of possibilities? Okay, turns out to be simple. I'm going to do a derivation. Derivations are not to be done during colloquia, right? So I'm breaking that rule, so you should watch my hands very carefully and ask questions, okay? So I'm going to use repeatability, unitarity, and the top of the list. I assume that there are two states, U and V, which can be measured repeatably. What does it mean? That means that there is an apparatus, which is also quantum, which starts in the state A0 in each case, and in one case becomes changed according to what the state U was, and in the other according to what the state V was. But the state U stays U. This is repeatability, right? I could bring another apparatus and do the same. Repeatability. Good. I think I see heads nodding, which is a good sign. So that's my key equation. Now there's a sort of longish derivation. I'm going to abbreviate it. I know that I'm doing quantum mechanics. Therefore, this evolution is unitary. If this evolution is unitary, that means that the scalar product of left-hand sides and right-hand sides must be the same. Right? So that means I have this equation. Now, that's a trivial-looking equation. So let's look at it anyway. Now, the temptation you have if you look at an equation like this is to do that. You simplify it. You divide both sides by the same factor. Great. I mean, we've got our solution. Well, actually, you've got a disaster in our hands. A0 is 1, right? I mean, that's what it is. State is normalized. So AU, AV is also 1. So that means that AU must be the same as AV. So that means that the measurement hasn't happened because there's no distinction between AU and AV. So what did we do wrong? Well, any guesses?
Yeah, are orthogonal ones.
Sorry?
U and V are orthogonal, right?
So there is an exception where this equation can work, even if A0 is 1 and AU, AV is less than 1. And you've pointed out when. The problem is we ignored the possibility that the scalar product of U and V is 0. If it's 0, then you can't divide by 0 both sides of the equation. In other words, either measurement is unsuccessful and we screwed up and the list is inconsistent, or, as the audience pointed out, U, V is 0. So we have, with extremely ascetic set of assumptions, a derivation of orthogonality of the outcomes.
I have a question then.
Please.
Because this would be true if I get the same outcome of the measurements.
Yes.
But if I have two states, U and Nu, which have the same outcome, they can also have different state A, U and A, V, right?
Yeah. Basically. Yeah. No, A, U and A, V should be different, right?
It should always have to be or not.
Well, I mean, you know, if A doesn't interact with U and V, there is still a trivial unitary evolution, right? So forget that, right?
Yeah, forget about this.
So otherwise, you know, so the important thing is AU and AV don't have to be orthogonal for this derivation to work. Anything except if they are identical demands orthogonality, right? I don't know if I'm answering your question,
yeah,
but...
Kind of.
Good, okay. But I mean, this is a sort of extremely powerful statement, very restrictive, which comes out of nowhere. predictability implies restriction to orthogonal states. Discreteness, which quantum theory comes up with, right? I mean, unitarity, Hilbert space, it says all continues. You say repeatability, you got discreteness, right? You have discrete set of options. This is a premonition of collapse, right? If you say repeatability, you will have things which will keep on being distinct and you will be able to confirm them. Please. Yes. This is why I was able to write that equation on the bottom. You could, yeah. I mean, you know, any interior evolution is, I mean, you dagger and you go backwards. Yeah. Yeah, you would get back here, right? Yeah. Any other questions? Please.
So I don't know if it makes sense, but this derivation looks kind of connected to cloning. Or?
Absolutely. Absolutely. This is why I was so surprised that I didn't come up with it when I came up with cloning. I came up with this one 25 years after cloning, right? So consequences and extensions, since you are... By the way, these are my events, right? Yes. We're going to stay here past 5. I hope you realize. Yeah, if there was, that's right, no, good question. I mean, I'm not going to go back, but I'm going to... So if there was entanglement, you would not have repeatability. You see that?
Well, usually you can imagine...
So the funny thing is... Yeah, so, I mean, it's probably for longer discussion later, but let me just now state what I know, which is I can't... do a delta epsilon thing so that I let it be a little bit less reversible and sort of gain something somewhere else in a gentle way. Things fall apart, right? So, you know, the decisiveness of this statement is worrisome. There was some other quick question, was there? Please.
So in the axioms, you have
unitarity. Yes. I don't have probabilities. Probabilities have been banished.
Okay, so why do you require unitarity?
Because that's what quantum mechanics tells me. Dirac tells me that before probability, right? I know that Hamiltonians are generating evolutions, right? I mean, you know, you can run in circles, and we can do it later, right? But but for now, I have my assumptions, and I'm starting from them. You can start from another set and we can discuss it, right? I like mine. I don't understand probability. Let me make a stronger statement, which I will not justify. I do not understand probability as well justified outside of quantum mechanics. And I'm going to repeat it later. I hope we're still within... with some audience left, because time is, I'm running behind. Okay, so let me go quickly through this. Derivation of quantum jumps, key to collapse postulate. I have events. Implies observables are Hermitian, right? If the outcomes are orthonormal, observables are Hermitian. Proof similar of no cloning. Proof can be extended to an apparatus or environment is initially in the mixed state. Amazingly, you can extend the proof when you have an apparatus which is plugged into the wall and interacting with the environment, and you require repeatability in the apparatus, right? Requiring repeatability in a quantum system is kind of silly. If you measure a photon, most of the time you don't have a photon, not just the state of the photon, right? Where you need repeatability in a quantum world is when you make an apparatus out of quantum pieces, and this gives you... not this, but a more sophisticated proof along the same lines gives you repeatability at the level of memories, you know, neurons, not yet qubits. Axioms, repredictability or repeatability is key to the proof. And information transfer need not be deliberate measurement. Information that leaks out due to decoherence, the same story. There's preferred set of states. The states which are coming out of here survive repeated transfer of information, which was what was also the story with decoherence. Repeated interaction states that survived. Okay. So we have distinguishable events. Let's go back to our plan. We want to get to Born's rule before too late. We now check off events. Okay, we have them. Let's do Born's rule. Why does Born's rule yield probabilities? Now let me remind you first of where Born's rule comes from. Here's a paper, it's actually English translation, of a paper of Max Born, 1926. He was considering collisions of, I think, electrons with atoms and trying to connect that, you know, with what experimentally saw and the wave functions. First page of the paper. There is an interesting footnote. This paper was originally intended for the Naturwissenschaften, but could not be accepted there for lack of space. Nobel Prize 25 years later. Okay, let's go to the second page. And I'm just looking at the part which is crucial, right? So he says, if one translates this result in terms of particles, only one interpretation is possible. Psi, where psi is the amplitude, gives the probability. Now wait a second. Psi gives the probability? That's not what textbook now say. Oh, but there is a footnote. Addition and proof. More careful consideration shows that probability is proportional to the square of the quantity psi. Again, Nobel Prize, 25 years. So do your proofs carefully. So how are we going to go about deriving probabilities? Now, the usual approach is to count the number of things that have happened, right, and do frequencies. But that's actually not the original approach to probabilities. The original approach to probabilities was funded by French aristocrats. It was first successful, very successful case of funding science in probably, well, I don't know. Archimedes was funded by a king in Syracuse. So what happened? French aristocrats played cards and all sorts of games of chance, and they didn't know how to bet. And they were losing huge amounts of money and castles and so on. So they enlisted French mathematicians to get them to understand how to bet so that they won't lose that much. So beginning of probability has to do with cards. And this is something that was brewing at the time when Laplace was the greatest French mathematician, and he codified it. This is known as equal likelihood, and the story is here you have two cards. You desperately want a spade, and you know that one and only one of them is a spade. When is the probability of a card being a spade in this situation equal to 1/2? Well, when you don't care if they are shuffled before you get one, right? So this is based on your ignorance. Turns out, once you prove equal probability for a certain set of events, you can build the whole structure of the theory of probability out of it. And Laplace did that. And there are beautiful discussions of it. There's a fantastic book by Russian Gnedenko from, I don't know, 30 years ago, which does it along with everything else which was done along these lines. Now, the problem with that is that this is purely subjective. I don't want to be responsible for probabilities, for entropy of the universe, and so on. And you know that if you were sitting under the table and the table was made out of glass, you would see that actually physical state of the cards have changed. And Laplace couldn't do anything about it. And the reason he couldn't is because he didn't know quantum mechanics yet. So how do we do it in a quantum world? Let me imagine cards. The cards I'm interested in, I want to attribute probabilities to, sit on a table S. But they're entangled with card that sits on a table E. So I have entangled cards. And now I want to shuffle them in full view of everybody. No mumbo jumbo. I shuffle cards on table S. Right? This quantum state, after shuffling, transforms into a quantum state which is orthogonal to this state. So the state of the universe has changed. Right? So the probabilities for this can be anything, can be different. But now I can restore the state of the universe without touching cards on table S. Right? How do I do it? Well, simple card trick. I shuffle cards on table E. There's no interaction between them, right? They are just entangled. One is here, the other can be behind Jupiter. The state of the universe is restored because shuffling here can be undone by shuffling there. So this means that the shuffling here, meaning on table S, changed nothing that could be detected on table S. Because I could have undone it by doing something very far away that has nothing to do with table S. So the probabilities in this case must be equal of the heart and the club. Not the club, a spade. That's the gist of the story. Notice that if I had coefficients here, alpha and beta, this would fall apart. I would not restore the pre-shuffling state. Right? So the fact that the coefficients are equal, I should say almost equal, and I will tell you why almost, is important. Okay, so let's do it slightly different notation, same thing. Okay, so I have a system composed of two parts. I'm going to call one of them systems, the other environment could be Alice and Bob or whatever, names don't matter. And that state will have the properties that it can be transformed in such a way that only by acting on the S part, I can make it into something else, but I can get back to the original state only by acting on the E part. Okay, so in other words, psi SE is invariant, and invariant stands for entanglement-assisted invariance. When this acting on this makes it into something else, but then you can undo whatever S did to SE just by acting on E. Right? That's what I did with cards. Simple example of that is an entangled state of the system. I'm writing it in the Schmidt decomposition. Now, I don't want to, at this stage of the lecture, explain what Schmidt decomposition is. So very briefly, if you have a pure state in a Hilbert space that's composed of two pieces, you can always write it so that you sum only over the states in the smaller of the two pieces. That's a theorem of algebra, linear algebra, which predates quantum mechanics. So it must be true, and it's not anything to do with quantum mechanics, right? I'm going to just use it. This is true. These coefficients are complex coefficients. States are orthonormal. Okay? Schmidt decomposition. Now, a very simple transformation of the sort that I just described would be just rotating these states, the phases of these coefficients, by acting on the system S.
right?
This U unitary operator just acts on the system S. Phases get changed. They acquire a phase. But I can rotate these phases in the opposite direction by acting just on the system E. So it's very clear that phases of a Schmidt decomposition don't matter. In other words, there is a sort of disappearance of significance of phases in case of entanglement, which is happening at a very basic level and which hints at what decoherence does. Decoherence also makes it impossible for interference to happen. This is what this did. Now, let me do a simple case where all of the coefficients differ only by the phase. And I'm going to prove in this case, and the proof is going to be basically a repetition of the card trick, that the probabilities must be equal. How do I do that? Well, I do a swap transformation. I swap a state SL with SK, right? This is going to produce a different state. How do I undo it in a way which is invariant? I swap the corresponding states of the environment and fix a phase if the phase needs fixing, right? Again, this is just what you've seen before in a different notation. Because there are n different options here, which are orthogonal, probability of any one of them by normalization is 1 over n. So I have, in this case, derived probability from a very basic, unquestionable, I think, assumptions. Okay, that's the hard part. I mean, I think many of you would have believed me if I said, oh yeah, amplitudes are equal, except for the phase that the probabilities must be equal. That's the hard part of the proof. So if you have any objections, pose them now, because we'll be done in 7 minutes and then it's going to be too late. Okay, no objections. I think you don't want to wait 7 minutes. Okay, so what's the trick now? The trick now is that if you have a state which doesn't have equal coefficients, you can turn it into a state which has equal coefficients in a bigger Hilbert space. How do you do it? I call it fine graining, and I have a very simple example here, so I'm going to go through it. The system S has just two states, 0 and 2, and that's a first cat here. The environment has three states, 0, 1, and 2, and the plus state which appears here is a superposition of 0 and 1. I'm going to add an auxiliary environment which acts with this environment in such a way that it's basically a controlled node, except that you have three options other than two options. In other words, this is 0 plus 1 is going to act with 0, and 0 in here with 0 here is going to give me 0, 0. 1, which is in here with 0 here, is going to give me 1, 1. And 2, which is here with 0, is going to give me 2, 2. Okay? Simple enough. So now my state is like this. And now I can start swapping things because the coefficients are equal. So for example, I can swap 0 with 2, and I can compensate for it by swapping 2, 2 with 0, 0. I can do all sorts of swaps. Probabilities must be equal. Now, these are probabilities of fine-grained states, of these joint states. But only one of them contains ingredient 2. There is three equally probable possibilities, but probability of 2 must be 1/3. So I got there without additivity or any of the stuff which is normally used in this sort of situation. But because I know that the whole must be 1, probability of 0 must be 2/3. So somehow magically, not magically, square roots, which were here, got squared. Magic is really in the fact that Pythagoras' theorem holds in Hilbert space. That's where squaring comes from. Okay, any questions at this stage? We are drawing to a very quick close, so don't be shy. Yes. Oh, I've before shown that phases don't matter, right? Phases are invariant, right? I mean, on the previous transparency, I dealt with phases, and several transparencies before as well. So phases I can always get out of. Somebody is nodding their head in the wrong direction, so please ask me afterwards. I think the fellow who asked the question agrees, the fellow below doesn't. So let's have it out. Okay. So in this case, I have probability I have derived Born's rule. I can do it whenever the coefficients are roots, square roots of rational numbers. There's an elegant way that I think I've heard from Walter Thiering at some point when I was describing this to him. He said, the question was, and how do you do it for numbers which are irrational? And then he said, oh yes, of course. Rational numbers are dense in the set of real numbers. And this did it for him. So I'll just repeat what he said. And I won't go through this. I won't torture you with this. I mean, I think you can believe that if I did it for two-thirds, I can do it in general. Invariance summary. And I'm going to stop here. I won't go beyond. But let me go through the summary. There is a new symmetry, invariance of joint quantum states. It relies on entanglement. It is related to causality. I haven't talked about that. In quantum physics, perfect knowledge of the whole, which we've had, may imply complete ignorance of the part. This is how we got probabilities. We knew completely the whole. Therefore, we could prove we can't know the states of the part. And one can do relative, one can, Born rule follows. One can do relative frequency interpretation, and one can do a lot of other things, foundations of quantum statistical physics, et cetera, et cetera. We can now go and start using Born rule again and believe in decoherence, but it's on much more profound foundations. There's a bunch of papers here. Again, the two on the bottom are mini reviews. If you remember one thing from this transparency or from this talk, it is this. Perfect knowledge of the whole may imply complete ignorance of the part. This is very quantum, based on entanglement, and it proves Born's rule in a very sort of intuitively, I think, satisfying way. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So there were already questions, so no more questions after the talk? Okay, so I will start. I mean, you mentioned about the, so you said about the, how big is the Hilbert space, how small is the corner, but also at the quantum mechanical level, if you take standard Hamiltonian, even the evolution, I mean, all the action will happen in a small part of the Hilbert space, also at the quantum level. Is this of any importance or not?
Well, I don't know if it's true, right? Because if I take a chaotic Hamiltonian, it's going to spread my state all over the Hilbert space. So I don't, I mean, you know, in many cases, and these are the ones we can solve. I mean, that's a sort of honest admission, at least on my part, right? I mean, you know, we've both looked at Ising model for this reason, right? So, but you know, if you have a general Hamiltonian, it's going to take you all over the place. If you ever take chaotic Hamiltonian, it's going to go crazy.
Bond's rule postulated?
Sorry?
Why didn't you like Bond's rule postulated? Because actually we all know that Bond's rule is postulated. You have actually demonstrated why. Demonstrated, actually. Yeah, why?
I like Bond's rule. I mean, I've used it to do decoherence for 20 years, right? So I think, you know, it clearly works, right? But it comes out post discussion of measurements in a way which is unnatural, because which violates its postulate four. It violates collapse, et cetera, et cetera, right? So I thought I need to derive it in a way which is convincing from very basic postulates. So this is, I like it, right? It's just, it's better to derive it. And not that's the only one. By the way, I should say, the first one who did the derivation, which is much more mathematically sophisticated, but much more physically, much less physically clear, is Gleason. It's a beautiful paper, which is very hard to read from the 50s. And basically, it started the ideas that Bond's rule should be derived, and people tried to derive it in a way which is, you know, physically appealing, and, you know, Everett tried it, DeWitt tried it, et cetera, et cetera. Tiering tried it, and so on.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, he had two. He had a reservation.
Okay. The other question is about the derivation that you, the only derivation that you gave us about if you have two states.
Orthogonality.
Exactly. I'm not sure that if you have a coupled system, you can decouple the evolution to be a unitary one. Because if you have a quantum, because the problem is that evolution are unitary only if you consider the total system. If you want to evolve just one of them, usually the evolution is not unitary.
That's known as decoherence. Okay. Yeah, no, so I absolutely agree, and I think it doesn't change the conclusions. Bigger discussions that would have to go into it. I did it in the case where the math is simple, right? But I also did it in the case where you are, your system is coupled to the environment. You can change even the entropy of the system, right? So the evolution is not unitary. What you demand is the universe as a whole be quantum, and what you demand is that the system you are using to keep records of something has the property that you can extract the same record repeatably, right? So the state of that system is changing. But it has to be, there has to be, you know, constraint on how it's changing so that it still remembers what it should remember. And it's a much harder proof, but you know, the idea is basically the same. There's a paper, I think I've cited it, Fizrev A 2013, I wrote on the subject.
Okay, all this is beautiful, but the main problem of quantum mechanics is the measurable. What is a measurement? How come worms don't make measurement human make?
How much who?
How come worms don't make measurements?
I disagree. I think worms make measurements.
How they found measure?
They don't. They measure which leaf is edible, which is not. They measure with a base, and they do hide from birds.
Seriously, how do they found measurements? Because this is the main problem in quantum mechanics. So do we find measurements?
Okay. So I don't define measurement. I define information transfer, right? And information transfer is what I talked about. System A influences the state of system B. The system is influencing the state of the apparatus. This is the level at which I operate, right? I am extremely interested in more philosophical views, but I don't know how to calculate once I enter into that area, so I stay away until I'm able to. But I think this constrains the possible set of answers.
Okay, so let's thank Professor Zurek again. Thank you very much.